much. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Today, we honor veterans, and it's not only Veterans Day to us, even though it's a day early. And the reason it's a day early is because a lot of our veterans like to partake in community events and parades, and so we're giving them the opportunity to attend our event as well as the community's. Today is also the 241st anniversary of the Marine Corps. So let's give our Marines a round of applause. We use words like heroes, sacrifice, courage, and commitment, which are befitting of our veterans sitting in front of you today. Again, I'd like to welcome students, staff, guests, and honored veterans here. We're celebrating Veterans Day today. We really have three purposes for having you here. Of course, the first one is to honor all the veterans who have devoted and sacrificed time, effort, and for those who couldn't be here, their lives, in honor of our country. Secondly, we hope you enjoyed the breakfast, and I hope you enjoy the speeches and musical performances that you're about to hear. And lastly, our educational purpose is to help teach and inform our students about exactly what a veteran is and why they can do those things that they do because of your service to our country. So as we proceed, also keep in mind that there are thousands of men and women in uniform around the world, in Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, still securing our freedoms and developing safety for us here at home. So please remember those in your thoughts and prayers. I'd like to introduce our first student speaker of the morning. Please welcome Daniel Janowski.
Good morning, honored guests and fellow students. I would like to introduce other students who will be speaking this morning. They are Joanna Malik, Kyle Split, Annalise Antunes, Danielle Laura, Belinda Lopez, and Sergio Cortez. We will begin this morning's program with Joanna Malik.
Origin of the Pledge of Allegiance. On September 8, 1892, the Boston-based The Youth's Companion magazine published a few words for students to repeat on Columbus Day that year. Written by Francis Bellamy, the circulation manager and a native of Rome, New York, he sent out thousands of leaflets to public schools across the country. Bellamy felt that a vow of loyalty or allegiance to the flag should be the dominant theme. He especially stressed the word allegiance. Beginning with the new word, allegiance, he then decided that pledge was a better school word than vow, and that my flag was preferable to the flag. And the true reason for allegiance to the flag is the republic for which it stands. Bellamy then reflected on the sayings of Revolutionary and Civil War and concluded that all those conflicts and struggles reduced itself to three words, one nation indivisible. On October 12, 1892, the quadricentennial of Columbus's arrival in the Americas, more than 12 million children recited the Pledge of Allegiance, thus beginning a required school day ritual that continues today. At the first National Flag Conference in Washington, D.C., on June 14, 1923, a change was made. For clarity, the words, "the flag of the United States," replaced "my flag." In the following years, various other changes were suggested, but were never formally adopted. It was not until 1942 that Congress officially recognized the Pledge of Allegiance. In June of 1954, an amendment was made to add the words, "under God." Then, President Dwight D. Eisenhower said, "In this way, we are reaffirming the transcendence of religious faith in America's heritage and future. In this way, we still constantly strengthen those spiritual weapons which forever will be our country's most powerful resource in peace and war." Thank you. It is my pleasure to introduce Daniela Lara.
Origin of the Star-Spangled Banner. On September 13, 1814, Francis Scott Key visited the British fleet in Chesapeake Bay to secure the release of Dr. William Beanes, who had been captured by the British after the burning of Washington, D.C. The release was secured, but Mr. Key was detained on ship overnight during the bombing of Fort McHenry, one of the forts defending Baltimore during the War of 1812. In the morning, he was so delighted to see the American flag still flying over the fort that he began a poem to commemorate the occasion. First published under the title Defense of Fort McHenry, the poem soon attained wide popularity as sung to the tune "To Anacreon in Heaven." The origin of this tune is obscure, but it may have been written by John Sanford Smith, a British composer born in 1750. The Star-Spangled Banner was officially made the national anthem by Congress in 1931. And although it already had been adopted as such by the Army and the Navy, we sing the opening stanza of the fourth stanza song to honor the flag and bravery of those who defend it. With that being said, would everybody please rise as the Wheeling R High School ROTC Color Guard will present our colors. And upon conclusion of their presentation, would everybody join Belinda Lopez and Sergio Cortez in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance and remain standing for playing of the national anthem.
Hope. Counter march. March. Color guard. Hope. Present. Colors.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Of the United States flag. No one knows with absolute certainty who designed the first stars and stripes or who made it. Congressman Francis Hopkinson seems most likely to have designed it, and a few historians believe that Bessie Ross, a Philadelphia seamstress, made the first one.
until the executive order of June 24, 1912, neither the order of the stars nor the proportions of the flag was prescribed. Consequently, flags dated before this period sometimes show unusual arrangements and odd proportions, these features being left to the discretion of the flag maker. In general, however, straight rows of stars in proportions similar to those later adopted officially were used. There are five principal acts affecting the flag of the United States. They are, on June 14, 1777, in order to establish an official flag for the new nation, the Continental Congress passed the First Flag Act. Resolved that the flag of the United States be made of 13 stripes, alternated red and white, and that the Union be 13 stars, white and a blue field, representing a new constellation.
Then, an act of January 13, 1794, provided for 15 stripes and 15 stars. An act of April 4, 1818, provided for 13 stripes and one star for each state to be added to the flag of the on the 4th of July, following the admission of each new state, signed by President Monroe.
An executive order of President Taft, dated June 24, 1912, established proportions of the flag and provided for arrangement of the stars in six horizontal rows of eight each, a single point of each star to be upward. Finally, an executive order of President Eisenhower, dated August 21, 1959, provided for arrangement of the stars in nine rows of stars staggered horizontally and 11 rows of stars staggered vertically. Thank you. I would like to introduce the MacArthur Chorus, who will sing Legacy of Heroes.
American soldier was buried in Arlington National Cemetery. This site, on a hillside overlooking the Potomac River and the city of Washington, D.C., became the focal point of reverence for America's veterans. Ceremonies have occurred earlier in England and France, where an unknown soldier was buried in each nation's highest place of honor. In England, Westminster Abbey, and in France, the Arc de Triomphe. These memorial gestures all took place on November 11th, giving universal recognition to the celebrated ending of World War I, fighting at 11 a.m., November 11th, 1918, the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. The day became known as Armistice Day. Armistice Day officially received its name in America in 1926 through a congressional resolution. It became a national holiday 12 years later by similar congressional action. If the idealistic hope had been realized that World War I was the war to end all wars, November 11th might still be called Armistice Day. But only a few years after the holiday was proclaimed, war broke out in Europe. 16.5 million Americans took part. 407,000 of them died in service. More than 292,000 in battle. Realizing that peace was equally preserved by veterans of World War II and the Korean War, Congress was requested to make this day an occasion to honor those who have served America in all wars. In 1954, President Eisenhower signed a bill proclaiming November 11th as Veterans Day.
On Memorial Day, 1958, two more unidentified American war dead were brought from overseas and buried in the plaza beside the unknown soldier of World War I. One was killed in World War II, the other in the Korean War. In 1973, a law passed providing burial of an unknown American from the Vietnam War, but none were found for several years. In 1984, an unknown serviceman from the Vietnam War was placed alongside the others. To honor these men, symbolic of all Americans who gave their lives in all war, an Army Honor Guard, the 3rd U.S. Infantry, the Old Guard, keeps day and night vigil at the gravesite. A law passed in 1968 changed the national celebration of Veterans Day to the fourth Monday in October. It soon became apparent, however, that November 11th was a historic date of significance to many Americans. Therefore, in 1978, Congress returned the observance to its traditional date, November 11th. The focal point for official national ceremonies for Veterans Day continues to be the Memorial Amphitheater built around the Tomb of Unknown Soldiers. At 11 a.m. on November 11th, a combined color guard representing all military services executes present arms at the tomb. The nation's tribute to its war dead is symbolized by the laying of a presidential wreath. The bugler plays taps. The rest of the ceremony takes place in the amphitheater. Every year, the President of the United States urges all Americans to honor these commitment of our veterans through appropriate public ceremonies, this being one of them. Thank you. I would like to introduce our orchestra director, Mr. Boyer, and the MacArthur Orchestra, who will play the Armed Forces Tribute.
Thank you.
whose author is unknown, is called I Am the Flag of the United States.
I am the flag of the United States of America. My name is Old Glory. I fly atop the world's tallest building. I stand watch in America's halls of justice. I fly majestically over institutions of learning. I stand guard with power in the world. Look up and see me. I stand for peace, honor, truth, and justice. I stand for freedom. I am confident. I am arrogant. I am proud. When I am alone with my fellow banners, my head is a little higher. My colors a little truer. I bow to no one. I am recognized all over the world. I am worshipped. I am saluted. I am loved. I am revered. I am respected, and I am feared. I have fought in every battle of every war for more than 200 years.
I was flown at Valley Forge, Gettysburg, Shiloh, and Appomattox. I was there at San Juan Hill, in the trenches of France, in the Argonne Forest, in Anzio, Rome, on the beaches of Normandy, in Guam, Okinawa, and Korea. Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan know me. I was there, and I am still there. I led my troops. I was dirty, battle-worn, and tired, but my soldiers cheered me, and I was proud. I have been burned, torn, and trampled on the streets of countries I have helped set free. It does not hurt me, for I am invincible. I have been soiled upon, burned, torn, and trampled in the streets of my own country. And when it's done by those whom I've served in battle, it hurts. But I shall overcome, for I am strong. I have slipped the bonds of earth and stood watch over the uncharted frontiers of space from my vantage point on the moon. I have borne silent witness to all of America's finest hours, but my finest hours are yet to come. And I am torn into strips and used as bandages for my wounded comrades on the battlefield. When I am flown at half-mast to honor my soldier, or when I lie in the trembling arms of a grieving parent or at the grave of their fallen son or daughter, I am proud. Thank you. Please welcome again the MacArthur Chorus and Orchestra as they perform God Bless America. Please sing along if you wish.
To
Some of our veterans are easy to recognize. They wear uniforms, medals, and ribbons. Most veterans, however, live among us quietly and anonymously. They are Americans' own sons and daughters. Let's consider for a moment the question, who is a veteran? A veteran is an elderly gentleman sitting on a park bench who helped liberate a Nazi concentration camp during World War II. A veteran is the grizzled service station mechanic who showed extraordinary courage at the 38th parallel during the Korean War. A veteran is the nurse taking care of newborns in a hospital nursery who once bandaged burned and bloody limbs at Da Nang during Vietnam. A veteran is a prisoner of war who once returned home to face a culture he didn't recognize and how he finds himself able at last to tell his story to his adult children. A veteran is a police officer driving her patrol car through the neighborhood who spent 6 months in Saudi Arabia making sure armored personnel carriers didn't run out of fuel during Desert Storm. A veteran is the older college student who braved the heat and terrorists while in Iraq or Afghanistan during Operation Enduring Freedom. On Veterans Day, we honor all people who served in our armed forces. They stand proudly in the timeline of history. Many war heroes and visionary military leaders stand in this line of selfless service. Some bear visible signs of their bravery and service. Others carry inner signs, a soul forged and shaped by battle. Today, we offer special recognition to veterans who face the horrors of war, and especially those who gave their lives in service to the nation. They and their families deserve our highest praise and eternal gratitude. We remember and salute all fallen heroes today and thank their families for their ultimate sacrifice.
However, a veteran is not only someone who fought in a war. Listen to the words of a staff sergeant who served during Desert Storm. I greatly admire and respect my heroes and friends in the desert for their courage, stamina, and superb performance during Desert Storm. Yet, let's not discount the accomplishments of all who stayed back in the garrisons and training fields in America. We also served, yet in ways that don't grab headlines. We kept on doing what we were paid to do, training soldiers. We played a critical role in caring for the families left behind. We helped ensure that thousands of Guard and Reserve soldiers were fit to fight. We took on the rear area workload, which needed to be done right. These are powerful words and true ones. And let's not forget to honor the many other veterans who served during peacetime and those who deployed during operations other than war. All soldiers commit to putting their lives on the line. As we saw in Mogadishu, Somalia, and at the American Embassy in Nairobi, Kenya, as well as Fort Hood, Texas, and at the Washington Navy Yard, soldiers die in operations other than war. All soldiers train and maintain a constant state of readiness so that whenever the nation needs them, they are ready to serve, and if necessary, to fight and die for their country. Therefore, on Veterans Day, we recognize and honor the many veterans who supported our war fighters, as well as all the soldiers who served during peacetime. We recognize the fullest possible definition of the term veteran as any person who served in the armed forces, past and present, at home and abroad, in peacetime and in war, and on active duty, in the Army Reserve and in the Army National Guard. We honor them today as we have for 92 years. We owe all American veterans a profound debt of gratitude. The freedoms and opportunities we enjoy today were bought and paid for with their devotion to duty and their sacrifices.
Your contributions and acts of selfless service make a profound difference in our world. We praise you, we honor you, and we thank you.
Thank you. I would like to introduce Mr. Lee and Mr. Oms, who will introduce our veterans here today.
When your name is announced, veterans, please stand up and be recognized. J. Katzman, United States Air Force, United States Coast Guard, Vietnam. Dennis Kurtzing. Rod Turner, United States Navy, Vietnam. Frank Udell, United States Marine Corps, Vietnam. Bill Starr, United States Army, Vietnam, Bosnia, and Kosovo. Tom Grimmer, United States Navy, Desert Storm. Robert Bors, United States Army, Korea. Christopher Rogers, United States Army, Operation Enduring Freedom. Robert Galley, United States Army, Vietnam. Ed Obrachta, United States Navy, Korean War. Dutch De Groot, United States Army and United States Air Force, Vietnam, Desert Storm, Operation Iraqi Freedom and Enduring Freedom. Patrick A. Windsor, United States Army, Vietnam. Dave Coughlin, United States Navy, 1955 through 58. David Geist, United States Army, Vietnam. Howard M. Richardson, Army Tank Corps, World War II, and the first occupation of Japan. Robert W. Resnick, United States Army, Cold War 62 through 79. Ron Blake, Army 3rd Infantry Division, Vietnam. Richard Tibbetts, United States Army, Vietnam.
John Sullivan, Army Desert Storm Operation Enduring Freedom. Virgil Wendt, U.S. Army Korean War. Justin Venetucci, Army National Guard, Vietnam War. Lee Jensen, Army Korean War. Roger C. King, United States Marine Corps, Korean War. Rich and Sue Berger, Army Korean War. Nick Helmer, U.S. Army Vietnam War. Fred Hoffman, Army. Charles Horn, Navy, Vietnam War. John Michael Yama, Army, Germany, 1958. Tom Pinedo, United States Marine Corps, Operation Enduring Freedom. Rudy Bartolozzi, Army, Korean War. Kurt Schumacher, Army, Korean War. Monica Takahashi, Air Force, Operation Enduring Freedom. Jack Schultz, Army, Korean War. Robert J. Lukey, United States Army 3rd Infantry Division, Vietnam War. Bob Bush, U.S. Navy, Vietnam War. Carl Campisi, Army, Berlin. Casey Coslow, Navy, Operation Iraqi Freedom, Operation Enduring Freedom. John Shurekowicz, Navy Air Corps, World War II.
Again, one big round of applause for all of our veterans here today. Thank you, soldiers.
Thank you.
Before we dismiss and conclude, there's some thank yous I'd like to share. First, I'd like to thank Mrs. Harris for being our sign language interpreter. I'd like to thank Mr. Simpson, Ms. Murray, Mr. Boyer, and the band, choir, and orchestra for their performances. I'd like to thank our student speakers who so bravely got up in front of all their classmates and the veterans to speak today. Most of all, I'd like to thank our veterans and their families for attending here today. I hope you enjoyed being here as much as we enjoyed having you. Let me leave our students and our veterans with these thoughts. In social studies, our students begin to learn about the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Our students need to know, however, that it's the veteran and not the preacher who has given us the freedom of religion. It is the veteran and not the reporter who has given us the freedom of press. It is the veteran and not the poet who has given us the freedom of speech. It is the veteran and not the campus organizer who has given us the freedom to assemble and protest. It is the veteran and not the lawyer who has given us the right to a fair trial. It is the veteran and not the politician who has given us the right to vote. And it is the veteran who salutes the flag and who serves under the flag. Thank you. Thank you.